Hi everyone, welcome back to High School Science 101. Today we are covering something that's very, very important, but something that's not really covered in high schools, and that's research ethics. Every single researcher that deals with human participants needs to have a really good understanding of research ethics, otherwise their research won't be approved by the university, and they may actually cause harm to the people involved. Since a lot of high schools don't teach you about ethical research, I've created this video which summarizes some of the key points from the National Statement of Ethical Conduct in Human Research 2007, and this is a document that sets the guidelines for research within Australia. When we're conducting research involving humans, we need to remember to refer to them as participants, not as subjects, and we need to have an underlying respect for them as human beings. Respect their welfare, their beliefs, their customs, their privacy, confidentiality, and their cultural sensitivities. A crucial part of the partnership between you as a researcher and your participants is to minimize the amount of potential harm you could cause to them. Harm can be physical, psychological, social, economic, or legal. Your research involving humans will have a certain level of risk attached to it. For example, it could be a negligible level of risk, which means there's no foreseeable risk and it may just cause some inconvenience to your participants, or it could be a low level of risk, in which case there might be a bit of discomfort. The level of risk really depends on the type of harm that may be caused, the likelihood of that harm, and the severity of the harm. As a researcher, you must do everything possible to minimize the amount of harm to your participants. If you do intend to cause harm, you must also justify why your benefits of your study will outweigh the harm that you're causing. For example, you might be working on a cancer treatment, and the side effects of that treatment will cause a bit of harm, but the potential benefits of finding a cure for cancer may outweigh those side effects. Consent is another really important aspect of ethical research, and it basically involves giving people the capacity to choose whether or not they want to be involved in your research. This includes potential participants understanding what your research is about and what's required of them. There's a lot of key information that you need to give to potential participants. This includes the contact details of yourself and where complaints should be directed to, how their privacy and confidentiality will be protected, their right to withdraw at any stage, what the sources of funding are for your research, whether there's any payments to be made to participants, how your data will be managed and used, the likelihood of your research being published, and what you think the foreseeable benefits are of your research. Sometimes an opt-out approach is used, where the information is provided to potential participants, but they must actively tell you that they don't want to be involved, otherwise their consent is assumed. An example of this is organ donation. If you live in a country where they have an opt-out approach for organ donation, and you don't want your organs to be harvested to help other people if you pass away, then you need to actively tell them that you don't want that to happen. Otherwise, if you're involved in an accident and your organs can be harvested to help other people, then they will assume that you've provided consent because you haven't actively opted out. Sometimes, due to the nature of the research and if there's a very low risk of harm, the researcher can offer limited disclosure. This means that the participants only receive a very small amount of information about the study because it actually involves some sort of concealment or deception. A key issue to be mindful of is the issue of coercion and the risk of people feeling pressured to be involved in your study. This can be especially important depending on the relationship between the researcher and the people that you're trying to invite into your study. For example, if I'm a teacher and I want to invite my students to participate in my study, they might feel coerced or a sense of pressure to get involved in my study because I am their teacher, and this in itself becomes an issue. How you'll recruit the people to be involved in your study is an important decision, and you might even use more than one strategy in your project. Your method of recruitment should be relevant to your topic and context, and you must be able to justify why you've chosen to include or exclude certain people or groups of people from being involved in your study. You need to also consider whether your recruitment strategy interferes with your consent process. In other words, does your method of recruiting people interfere with their ability to voluntarily participate in your study? Again, this links in with that example that I just gave you of me being a teacher doing research with my students. If I recruit all the students within my classes that I personally teach, that could interfere with their ability to think that this is a voluntary study, and they might feel compelled to have to participate. When you've collected some results, you need to think about how easy it would be for others to identify people or organizations that have been involved in your study. Obviously, the chances of this happening are at their highest when you've used names or photos, but also be cautious of using birth dates, addresses, or regions. This area also concerns who has access to your data and how and where it is stored. Minimizing the amount of information you collect and store about each person, as well as replacing their names with codes or numbers, will help preserve their anonymity. That gives you a very broad overview of the main things you need to be mindful of when you're doing research involving people. Some other things that the standards cover that I haven't really gone into include data management, sharing of your data with other researchers, and communicating your results to your participants and other third parties. The standards also include a whole chapter on biological research, as well as another chapter on ethical considerations that apply to specific groups of people. These specific groups require special ethical considerations, and they include pregnant women, fetuses, children, people in dependent relationships, people who can't give consent due to their medical state, people with a mental impairment or disability, people involved in illegal activities, Indigenous people, and people in other countries. If you intend to do research through university, I would strongly recommend that you click on the link in the description and read these standards for yourself, or find the relevant standards for your country. Nonetheless, what I've covered in this video are the main things that you need to think about in order to make your research as ethical as possible. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you next time.